The gates at the Isabella Gardner Museum will stay locked while authorities search for clues in the daring weekend heist.
There are some significant paintings missing. By significant, there's a couple of Rembrandts and a Vermeer. And the ballpark figure on the cost is about $200 million.
Officials say the museum's elaborate surveillance system made no difference. Two men wore police uniforms and fooled the security guards.
They were allowed into the building. The two security guards were cuffed, and the theft then occurred.
What would you do if you had $1 million?
I'll tell you what I'd do, man. Two chicks at the same time, man.
This just a real nigga shit, your real nigga story, you know what I'm saying?
Just be the self-sub bitch.
I look great, right?
Yeah,
that's all I needed, Justin. That's all I needed. All right, ready to go?
Ready to
roll. Episode 18, is it?
18.
You sure? 18? Yep. Bundy knows. Today's a real good one. Real good podcast. We got a legend in the building and friend, Mr. Myles Connor, and his lifelong partner, Al Dotoli.
Dotoli.
I've been saying Dotoli, and he says it so fast on the phone. I think it's Dotoli. Al Dotoli. That's how it's pronounced. We got Mr. Bundles in the building. A couple other people. Myles Connor, anybody who's ever been in prison in Massachusetts or New England for that matter, you know, should know who this guy is. I know when I went in when I was 17, I've known who he was, you know, for a long time. The guy is just a legend in his own right. There was a book written about his life, but more importantly, there's a movie that was just made. The Rock and Roll Outlaw, The Ballad of Myles Connor, which is coming out. It's being debuted March 17th, St. Patty's Day.
2 p.m. at the St. Patty's Day.
The Regent?
2 p.m. the Regent Theater in Arlington.
In Arlington. Yeah, that's it's going to be awesome. St. Patty's Day is a special day for me. It always has been. Ironically enough, that's my sobriety date, 11 years sober.
And, good for you.
And haven't been back to prison since, you know, so... That's a good day for me. So I always go to the parade in Southie and go by Pat and E's house after. And I'm going to, you know, try to squeeze everything in that day because I really want to see this. You know, Al's been gracious enough to send me some clips of it. And it's unbelievable that going back as far as you guys known each other, that you've documented so much of this stuff on video. You know, in this day and age, everybody has cell phones and everything is being filmed and everything's documented. But to have someone like you who've documented this stuff going way back is really cool. And some of those photos and one of them, you know, I'll let you guys tell it, but Myles was a big rock and roll band out of Boston, you know, way back. And, you know, I couldn't help but, you know, thinking, you know, what could have been, because the guy is just ultra talented, ultra smart. Just, you know, Renaissance man, this guy is, you know, he's done it all, right? But he was so talented musically, but he was also talented being, an art thief and a bank robber and a prison escapee. You name it, you know, he's been involved in it. And, I'm going to pass it over to Al and Myles just to tell a little bit about how he started out and how you guys met. Milford, Massachusetts.
Milton,
yeah. You got the Maturanos.
Yeah, Jimmy.
You got the Tollies. You got the Connors.
Yeah.
I don't know what's in the water over there. But, you know, you got some characters coming out of that town. And, I'd like to pass it over to you just to, you know, let us know a little bit about yourselves and how you started out and how you met.
Well, I guess I should start that off by saying when I was younger, 14-ish, in Milton, of course, I wanted to play the guitar, so I bought myself a little guitar and I started plucking around with it. And I knew about this character that lived in town, Myles Connor, I actually had my brother's fake ID and went to see him perform one night, and I was just knocked out completely. And I decided to go to his house one day. So I drove over, I got a ride over, I wasn't old enough, knocked on the door, and for the most part, he graciously had me come in, and from then on, he taught me guitar, and we became close friends. And his music career just kept going and going and going, and then other things would get in the way, and I guess we should have him tell you a little bit about that. But every time we did something, we always had lots of interest from record companies, from promoters, from club owners. But, you know, when you're playing clubs and his name comes up in like the Blackfriars Massacre.
Oh,
well, that was Whitey and his gang saying they had to blame somebody. But he and I were up in Maine performing that night when they said he had done that. But so the criminal life eventually snuffed out the
music performing. Career.
Yeah,
I think it's, you know, pretty interesting, and it just goes to show you, you know, you're good guys. That everything that you've been through, you guys always remained friends, whether he was, you know, off in prison and you were off. You worked with Frank Sinatra.
I did.
Dionne Warwick, you managed your career. You were with the Rolling Stones for a period of time.
Spent some time with the Stones.
Ozzy Osbourne, which I found fascinating on your resume, from Frank Sinatra to Ozzy. I keep going back to that. That is just so cool. But what an interesting life, you know, you led, you know, in and of itself. But I mean, but Myles, you know, we were just out to eat before. We were talking about, and he got shot once. He got shot by the police also, didn't he? Or he shot at, and he shot a cop. But I didn't know they were robbing a bank. And the guy he was with, we brought his name, and I actually knew him. I don't know if we could say his name or whatever, but, you know.
Kenny Whiteman,
who escaped from Walpole. What a legend, Kenny Whiteman. But, yeah, you're telling that story. Just so many stories, and, you know, we're out to eat, and I'm just – like I said, your story is unbelievable, but, you know, Myles and seeing that they, you know, intertwined with each other, there was just so much. But, yeah, I'd like to, you know, let Myles tell a little bit of it, how he started with the rock and roll, and how he became the biggest and the most well-known art thief, you know, in the world. I mean, this guy stole a Rembrandt. I mean, just amazing, amazing stuff. So I could go on all day, but... You know, let Myles talk a little bit of, you know, well, as much as he wants, actually. Myles, you could just take this over if you want. But, yeah, just tell us a little bit how it started out and how you get into life of crime and you know, anything else.
Well, to quote Bob Dylan, peace and love. no, I started out in rock and roll. And Al Dotoli was my manager at that time. Even from a young age, like when we were in our teens, he was always doing promotions with local Arnie Ginsberg and giving us gigs at town halls and things like that. And then later on, we developed into local clubs and then bigger concerts and bigger places to, like, we played at Baggy Knees, which is in Stowe, Vermont, and the Rolling Stones had played up there, and that's what we were playing. And then I unfortunately had two vocations. One, of course, is rock and roll, and the other was robbing museums and robbing banks and things of that nature. And every time I'd almost get to the point of where Al would have me almost at the record deal or the big concert deals, I'd get into trouble because of all of the behaviors that I was involved in.
Yeah. So, you know, you're so close. You're almost at the pinnacle, right? Al's got you right. Al, you must have wanted to kill him a few times, right? I mean,
I still do. He was very consistent on fucking things. Oh, excuse me. He was very consistent on screwing things up. I mean, we had a lot of people in the industry that knew his talent. And I would bring people to see him who had no idea about what else he was up to.
Yeah.
And they'd look, and I knew what they were thinking. Oh, we're the first ones. This guy's unbelievable. And then we would go ahead. I even had three members of Shana backing up many times. They lived around here. They were friends of mine. But we were in the studio, and they were producing an album that I had pre-sold once we finished it. It was pre-sold. It was going to be the album. We finished one song completely. Strangely enough, it was called I Was the One. But the album, which was going to be finished, that was probably the biggest time that he screwed things up. But there were many, many, many more. Especially since when he was selling stolen artifacts that he had stolen from the Woolworth estate. The Woolworth estate, yeah. And he was selling them in a parking lot in Mashpee, and we were playing in a nightclub across the street from there. I set him up on a radio station that evening, and he to promote the show, and he did that. And on his way back from the radio station, he dropped the stuff off, not realizing that there was a snitch involved, and he arrested him right there.
Like that, always the way, right there in the radio station parking lot.
No, from the radio station, he went to the parking lot across from the nightclub. I'm at the nightclub, seeing that he's a little bit late. I see all these police and firemen, and I said to the club owner, "We better stop without him. That's him."
What were the artifacts? The Wyatt? Were they paintings or what?
From the Wyatt estate.
What was the estate?
What was the estate?
Wyatt paintings.
Well, if you don't mind me asking, so long ago, what were you selling them for?
It was my partner, Bobby Donati, who had actually set up the contacts. And it was for the sale of the paintings. And most of the time, most of the paintings that I stole were not for resale. They were for bagging chips to get myself or somebody else out of a jackpot with the police or the FBI. But this time, the deal was Bobby's deal. And so he had set up the appointment with the guy, and the guy was an informant, and that's how the FBI got involved. And actually, that's how I was the guy that went down there to meet him, and then I get grabbed.
You know, it's genius. And speaking of genius, I read somewhere that you were a member of Mensa. Is that true?
Yes.
Wow. So if people know what Mensa is, I mean, you're a legitimate genius, you know? Bundy's also. Bundy. Ironically, Bundy's up.
You're a Mensa member?
he thinks he is. But so I didn't really know that as much. I knew you were into, I read some other stuff. You were into samurai swords, a big collector, maybe the biggest in the world,
At one time, I had a collection that was as big as the collection at the MFA or the Met.
But you're well versed, so well versed. Maybe know more about samurai swords than anyone probably.
Far above what the average person would know. In fact, I would say at one point I was amongst the top 10 most knowledgeable people on the subject.
And you even traveled to Japan before, lived in Japan. That's amazing. Getting back to the bargaining chip, like I said, I didn't know that, but that is so smart. You know, like, you know, you're in a GM, right? You say, hey, you know, you guys have been looking for this. I can get it to you. And touching on that subject, you actually used a Rembrandt painting you stole once to get out of some type of GM you were in.
Yes.
And Mr. Dotoli was the man who returned it, maybe?
I would like to say
allegedly.
Well, I would just say it was returned by a tall master man. And I'm 6'4". So you can take it from there.
So where was the Rembrandt stolen from?
The MFA in Boston, Museum of Fine Arts.
Wow, the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, huh? You don't mess around, Mr. Connor. So you get this, I read like when the Isabella Museum, Stewart Gardner Museum was robbed. We'll get back to that after. I always read like when a painting like this is stolen, then you'll hear, oh, they cut it out of the frame, you know, it's ruined, and then I think that, you know, I always thought that was true. And then I hear, no, that's bullshit. They're not ruined. But when you steal a piece of art, like a Rembrandt painting, you know, walk us through it. How do you I go in, we rip it off the wall, the alarm goes off, me and Bundy get caught running out the back door 5 minutes later. How would a true, you know, like a professional like yourself, you're going in, you're getting this painting, how do you do it? You cut it right out?
Well, there's different ways to rob museums. But in regards to the MFA, it was on what they call the Dutch room, which contained a number of Dutch masterpieces. To the right, as you went up the stairs in the rear of the MFA. And so I knew the painting was alarms, but I also knew it could be taken off the wall. And so I just unhooked it. And then I had people waiting out. I had a person right beside me to act as a blockage in case anybody would get out of the way. And then I had other people down at the bottom of the stairs to dissuade anybody from chasing me down there, like the guards. And they were armed. And so I made down the stairways to the waiting van. And there was everybody. They made down to the rear doorway. And they all started to come out of the museum. And I had a friend who was down there with a machine gun. And he let go of the machine gun, aimed at the stairs. And it was like a vacuum cylinder. They all just disappeared on the bank, except for one Polish retired Boston cop. And he was a guard that was bound and determined nobody's gonna steal a painting on my watch. And so he chased after the painting. Wow. And chased back. I jumped into the back of the van with the painting. He latched right onto the painting. And so I had a friend in the back of the van with the machine gun. And I said, don't shoot the guy. Yeah. And so he clocked the guy on the top of the head with the gun. And lo and behold, the retired Polish boss police officer relinquished the grip on the penny. And off we went.
You know, not off subject, but it always amazes me. Like, you just think, you know, some guy who dies, you know, in a 7-Eleven, like trying to stop a robbery, or in this case, no matter what it is, whether it's a bank, some guy who's getting paid, an armored car driver who's getting paid, you know, 22 yeah. bucks an hour. You can't underestimate these guys. Some of these guys, well, like you said, this guy was, you know, it isn't his painting, right? It's insured. And, yeah. And this guy very likely could have died. Like you said, you let off a few rounds of machine gun yeah. and it didn't deter him one bit. No. It always blows my mind, someone like that. I'd just be like, hey, go ahead, pal. You know what I mean? Unless it's something, you know, near and dear to my heart. I'm not going to die over it, you know?
Different people react differently. And
yeah.
In the minds of some people, they're just, you know, good old tough cops.
Yeah.
Every time. Yeah. And that's his situation, I'm sure.
So now you have this Rembrandt, but how about the guys you do the score with? Did you get some other things where you sold and took care of them?
No, I was very successful as a bank robber, and I made a lot of money. I think the smallest bank I ever took down was $175,000. And this was in the 1970s.
Wow.
And I had taken a number of banks down. And so I had a large cache of cash.
Yeah.
And the people who were involved with me, I just paid cash.
Oh, all right.
To give me.
That's the first thing I thought of. All right. Well, if he's going to keep this Rembrandt and use it as a bargaining chip, well, how's, you know, he paying these guys that all got you back there? So, all right. Yeah, that makes sense. $175,000. I've knocked off a few banks myself.
You have?
Yes, but it was more of the drug addicted, pass the note guy. So when you said $175,000, you know, I think my biggest one was about $14,500. So we're, and that was in 2000, the last one. And
that was my 90s. Case of Cristal.
Do you still have the red dye? Yeah, yeah.
No, I was the guy like, no dye pack, spelling dye, D-I-E. Me myself wasn't a member of Mensa. So you get this Rembrandt now, and you just put this thing on ice, and you're thinking of the future already. I'm going to be in a jam someday. There's no doubt about it, right? That I'm going to be in another pickle.
No, I got that specifically to get me out of the one in Monmouth, Maine, the Woolworth Estate, because the FBI was very happy that they'd finally landed me. And his quote was, "Let's see you get out of this, Connors. It'll take you a Rembrandt to get out of this." I thought, "You're right."
No fucking way.
That's what gave me the impetus.
Here it is.
So were you, so the Woolworth Estate, that, where was that?
Monmouth, Maine.
So that was in Maine. So were you in federal court over that, or was that in the state of Maine?
No, the charge for that was I was arrested in Mass for that offense.
All right.
And then as part of the deal to return the Rembrandt to the MFA, that charge was dismissed.
Wow. So who, if you don't mind me asking, it wasn't long ago, who works out this deal where your lawyer, you say, "Hey, listen, I can get you that Rembrandt. You know, make sure they don't, you know, snook at you, right? Where you give it back and they say, "Hey, screw you," and they still bury you in Maine. Like, how do you negotiate that so everything's on the up and up?
Well, I can negotiate that through an attorney.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good stuff. So you got the Rembrandt, and that was that, and you returned that.
That was that, and I get a little cash returning.
Really?
My efforts.
It was a little reward also, huh?
Indeed, yeah.
So you did the guy who returned it get a cut? Did he get a small piece?
He's getting back to work.
I think I was in one of these moves where I didn't tell anybody about it. I got the reward back through a state police major that was a friend of mine, and he made the arrangement.
I was quite happy to see that returned, and it was done on my terms. We met at the, what did they bring? They brought him to Charles Street Jail.
Old Charles Street.
Jesus. So we should have conversations. It was already in motion that it was going to go back.
Yeah.
But because we weren't so close for all those years, everybody felt that I would have this thing. And from the beginning, first of all, I said, "You asshole, you're still
a lot of heat on
all right."
You.
So I didn't want anything to do with it. It was somewhere else. So I had to figure out how I was going to get it from someone else. And, you know, I have a family as well and kids. And, you know, people were popping in and out of the bushes. Yeah. And I had mafia people come up and open. I knew them a bit. And they said, "Hey, you know, just tell Myles if they think of us." And he opens up the briefcase and it's jammed with money. I mean, that stuff, they thought it was probably, "Hey, I'm going to myself, this has to stop." You know, I mean, somebody, and then you have the insurance people, they're all after me. So, because he's in jail and they're looking for the damn painting. So to me, my reward was getting that thing out.
Yeah, get it off your chest.
I did it on a Saturday night. So in those days, the Sunday Globe was the thing to tell people.
What was it?
The Sunday Globe.
Oh, yeah.
So I visualized on the front page of the Sunday Globe and made the transfer Saturday night just after dark.
Real cloak and dagger stuff, huh?
Well, there was only me going on time to run to just how it was done, but it was definitely talking to you. Serious shit, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. And also, you're worrying, right, that, you know, so much going on between, like you said, mafia things, insurance companies, cops, him, you're worried about getting pinched. And then you also got to worry about, you know, they'd love to grab you with it before you actually returned it and get him out of the jam. So now you got the thing waiting. I mean, that's what I'd be worried about, that I'm going to get pinched with the thing in my car or the van or what have you on the way to deliver it, and everybody gets screwed except them.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I worked out in a way where once it was in my hands and once I read what I needed to read that was on the back, I was supplied with a snapshot of what should be on the back of it, face down, I was once asked, did I ever stand and like looked at the Rembrandt while I was returning it? I said, "Are you shitting me? All I want to do is get rid of that thing as quickly as I could." So I never looked at the front. The identifying marks were on the back. You know, old marks that came from stamps the way they just stamped something, and he supplied me through somebody a picture of exactly what should be there. So all the years, there's all these little things on the back. So I was 100% sure that that was the case.
Yeah.
And then we went on from there.
What was the first time you ever thought of robbing a museum, or why? What? Well, obviously for money, probably. But what was your What got you into that? You were just well-versed in art and artifacts?
No, the first museum I ever robbed was as an act of revenge. My father, who was a very honest Millen police officer, and a gun collector, and at one evening, he came home and he was very much upset, and he told my mom and myself, he said, I can't believe those people at the Gardner Museum, they thought that I robbed the museum of the...
Forbes Museum.
I'm sorry.
It has nothing to do with the Gardner Museum. We got to throw that in there, all right?
Forbes Museum, and they'd gone to the chief of police, who's a friend of my dad's. They said, we understand you have a sergeant that works for you, and we understand he collects firearms, and we would like an investigation to see if he was involved. So the chief told my dad, and he thought it was kind of comical because he knew my father, but my father didn't think it was comical. And my father related to me, can you believe those Yankee stuck-up SOBs, they think that I stole their guns, anti-firearms. And so at that stage, he was so upset about it.
Besmirching his name. I
felt it was time for payback, and let those people know what a real thief did. And so I went back there, and there was a night watchman, a kid who was a watchman, but he used to go out, leave the museum, and visit his girlfriend, which I believe lived in Brockton, I believe.
So you did a little
and
homework.
He'd leave the museum unattended. So it was the old-fashioned B&E in the back window that was alarmed. And I took the anti-guns and a few other things, and I put them in the back of my car, and off I went. That was my first
one. That was your first one. Interesting. It was a revenge thing. It wasn't even a...
Yeah.
Did your father know that you ever did that on his behalf?
No, he never did.
Never let him know. I think maybe later in the years you'd say, hey, Dad, remember when that happened, you know?
Maybe I did later on.
Yeah. Wow, very interesting. So moving forward, you intertwined your rock and roll career with robbing banks.
The reason was, primarily I was, when I got out of Walpole for the first time, Al had set me up as being the president of rock and roll. And I had, by the way, when I got out, I was accepted to Harvard. And so my SAT scores were off the maps. And so I had made the requirements to get into Harvard. And they said, you have to realize if you come into Harvard, you have to give up any other thing you have going in your life because you'll be competing with some of the finest, smartest kids in this country and out of this country.
So Al said,
hey, listen, there's only one time you can be a rock and roll star, and that's when you're this age. Later on, you can go back to rock and roll. And that's why I stayed with rock and roll. I did not pursue the academic route. And while I was starting off in rock and roll, I was playing at a club that was well-known and well-packed called the Beachcomber.
I was going to say the Beachcomber. I just did
and
that for some reason.
All these guys who would get out of Walpole would come down and see me playing and sing through well. Of course, I'd give them a few bucks this time and that time. Then, it changed from that to, hey, listen, you're the only guy that I know that I can trust, and I've got the methadone clinic in Brighton that I can take that down. He did take it down for about $80,000 worth of methadones. That's in the 70s.
It's the pills then, right? The pills.
The big wafers, the 40 milligram wafers. And so then you've got other pals who are involved in bank robberies and stuff like that. And so it's hard to stay at the club making maybe $300 or $400 a night as opposed to robbing a bank and making night. Like I said, I think the smallest bank I ever robbed was $175,000. and that was in Rogersville. We went through the roof of the place, and they had a perimeter alarm, but they had no motion detectors. So we climbed up on the roof. It was Ralph, his brother Sal, and myself, and we had a sledgehammer and a big bar, and we went to the roof and dropped down and into the bank. And there we waited into the bank, until the teller came in.
No way. I was going to say, I thought you were going to the vault or something overnight.
No, so we had the teller had a timer on at the bank, vault had a timer. So she comes in. And we pop out, surprise. So we, now, meanwhile, she had to wait about 5 minutes for the vault to unlock. In the meantime, there are patients coming out to the door. Yeah. So we said, go up to the door and let, not patients, but the customers, let them in. So we let them in, sat them all down. And then when it was time for the vault to open, we got the money and we cleaned up the vault and off we went.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable stuff. What you said when you first got out of Walpole when you were going to go to Harvard, what year was that when you first bid?
1972.
Wow, 72. And what was your first bid for, if you don't mind me asking, Walpole?
I had been involved in the shootout with the police. I had shot one cop, shot at a second one. And I had been shot to hell myself. Whoa. And so it was assault with intent to kill charge. But because there was an element of self-defense, the judge, who was a hangman judge, Judge Eugene Hudson, recognized there was an element of self-defense because I did not start the shootout. They did. And he said, Mr. Connors, I'm going to sentence you to 12 to 20, but you'll be eligible for release in 6 years.
Two-thirds of the low end, was it? Yeah.
And the police were furious.
Yeah.
And so that was part of the reason for the intense dislike on the part of the Boston police.
That's what started it all, huh? They hated you ever since then. I mean, I couldn't see in this day and age, no matter if the cop shot first or what, you know, a suspect getting a self-defense case, you know, I mean. No, so March 17th on St. Patty's Day at the Regent Theater, you know, I really want to go to see this. I mean, Al sent me some clips of it. It looks official. It looks really good, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of cool pictures of you on stage and, you know, just looking like the real outlaw. Almost like a young Van Morrison. You get the red hair. You get the leather jacket.
I can see that.
It's really cool, you know. It's, you know, just some really cool stuff. You know, like when we were just out to eat, all of us, there was a bunch of us out to eat and we were talking. And I was saying how when I first went into jail and prison, I was 17 years old. And before that, I was in DYS and stuff. But when I started going into adult jail and prison, there was always, you know, these older guys, these, you know, stand-up guys, solid guys, or this guy, whether he's, you know, he's a mafia guy or this guy, you know, an armored car guy, or this guy's a safe cracker. Or it's like, and I tell people now, you go into jail, there's no more of that. There's no more real characters. Guys that were just criminals, not because they were addicted to drugs or you know, that's pretty much all you see in there now, unless it's a, you know, Skinner or just someone who killed somebody. But you don't really have any more guys that are just, you know, thieves.
Yeah.
You know, whether you're a stick-up guy or an armed robber or a safe crack or any of these, you just, you know, Bundy was a thief in his own right. There's some scores. But even him, you don't see guys anymore that are just criminals. Mm-hmm. You know, we grew up in a culture where there were guys that were just, you knew. You know, I mean, my father was always a bartender. I was down the bar since I was a little kid. And you'd see a guy, oh, he just got out of Walpole, this and that. And, you know, maybe I was guilty of looking up to these guys, you know. Yeah. And I ended up in the same place. But, you know, when you hear your story and I, you know, I can't wait to see the movie. It's, you know, it's got Hollywood written all over it. I mean, this story, I don't know how it isn't a movie, because it's just, I mean, it's just so unique. You know, your life story is so unique, and it's second to none. I don't think there are any other guy. I mean, I could, you know, pretty much bet my life, right? There are no other guys that are a rock and roll star and a bank robber and an art thief. I mean, it's you know, it's unbelievable unless, you know, the people that know, that grew up with you, that know you. And I mean, luckily everything's documented. You Google your name and see all this. You could see the book or the movie that's going to be coming out, more importantly. And it's just really cool stuff. You know, for me personally, I find it interesting. Like I recently been beating a dead horse about a guy who claimed to be something he isn't. I really don't even want to say his name anymore because it's getting played out. And hopefully, you know, he's been getting his comeuppance. But I said, it's like stolen valor. Like when someone comes in and tries to claim they're this or that, and they never put in the work to do it. But when I was touching on that, I basically said it's like this guy read every Boston mob book he could and just made up this story, and he actually sold it to a pretty big publishing company. But my point on that is, you know, we all know the same people. I know who you were and from prison, and everybody, if we didn't know each other personally, we have a friend that knows this one or that one. And Boston and Massachusetts, the Northeast, it's so small. Everybody knows somebody, right? And, you know, I've read all these books and come in, and I remember reading cases of yours in the law library in Walpole, you know what I mean? Because you were that guy. Yeah. You know, you were that guy running around the track. And just, you know, I didn't know a lot of this stuff that you know, got into jujitsu, or you're in Japan, or the samurai sword stuff. And, you know, you just think, oh, yeah, Myles Connor, the art thief, right? Or the bank robber. And then, you know, you sit down and you're talking with you, or you're talking with Al, or, you know, Anthony or Jimmy or whoever. And it's like another layer of the onion gets peeled back. Like, wow, really? You know, you did this too. And you did that. You did this. And Mentor. And what? His father was a cop. Like, just, it's just an amazing, you know, just what a journey, man. You know, and knock on wood, he's still here. Yeah. You know what I mean?
That's a surprising part.
Yeah, that is a surprising part. You got shot by the police 6 times, and you got shot by your own co-defendant, Kenny Whiteman, one time. Huh?
Yeah.
Tell the story about that when you were running to the bank with Kenny. He was telling me earlier.
It was bank up in Vermont. And I had given Kenny, I think it was, if I remember, it was a semi-automatic 45 Colt. And we went into the bank. The bank had bagged up the money to be picked up by the armored car. So it was already out. So we went in there, we grabbed the money bags, and we were on the way out. And on the way out, Kenny slips and his fingers go off with the gun and hits me right in the calf, hits the bone. And so I go, ouch. And of course, the people in the bank hear the gun go off. So now I hobble up. I said there was a side field, our bank, and then the cars were up there. And so Billy Oakle helped me up with the hobble up the embankment. And I got into the car. And then, because we knew that they would report the gunfire going off the car and the guy getting shot, I was fearful that the police might set up a roadblock and with any car with the mask plate and just maybe pull it over. So I didn't feel really safe even being in the trunk. So for 2 days, I stayed up there in Vermont in a barn, in a with hay, and I stayed up there for 2 days, and
I didn't bleed out.
You're right, but no veins were hit, but the bone was hit. So then I made it down to a friend of mine who was a chiropractor in Weymouth, and they have an X-ray machine, so he could take the X-ray of where the bullet was in my leg. Then I had another friend whose wife was a nurse, that would be Lenny, and I went to her house, and she had a friend who was an operating room nurse, and so therein, they could take a picture via the X-ray and see where it was, and they went in there with big tweezers and pulled out the bullet. Now I had to have a drainage and antibiotics. So I went to the hospital and not the county hospital, but
Brockton?
No, sure. No. What's Canton? Canton Hospital. I went into the Canton Hospital. And so I told them, I said, I was in the Blue Hills, and some SOB took a crossbow and shot me in the leg, and I was so pissed off, I just yanked the crossbow and threw it away.
That's pretty believable.
And so, now, because you have this wound, they had to notify the cops. And so a cop comes to me, he says, "Yo, Myles Connor?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Bow and arrow in the leg?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "I don't more believe that story than I believe in Santa Claus, but I don't have a bullet, so I can't do anything to you." And so that was the end of that story.
Wow. So that was that before getting shot by the cops or after?
After.
Oh, yeah, that was after, yeah.
Very after. I mean, kind of a stupid question, right? But any lingering damage from the gunshots that still,
not really.
Still bother you today? Mm-hmm. Really?
Not really. No, you're lucky.
I mean, he was in his 20s when the police shot him the first time in Boston.
Yeah. Did you dig up any of those old news clippings or anything?
Oh, yeah, there's plenty of that in there. Really? It shows him in the film, by the way.
Yeah.
There was by the time the police were able to get up there, they were scared to death of what the hell he was doing.
Yeah.
The press had all converged down below.
It was like dog day afternoon.
Yeah. So as he came down, I have plenty of it. A front page, it was the Herald. It showed the firemen holding him in that gurney, all strapped in, blood everywhere, and him out cold, with a crowd around him.
Wow.
Yeah. And he's told me more than once, and I also had somebody that was there that day that confirmed it. So when they shot him up top after the gun battle, they were going to throw him off. They wanted to throw him off the building.
Threw the guy out. No, I'm just joking.
So the first people to come up on the ladder and not through the stairs, that was the police, was the fireman. Fireman.
If he wasn't there, you probably would have got...
You know,
he's the guy that saved my life.
Yeah, they probably would have chopped you off the...
And he heard them saying, "All right, let's throw this son of a bitch off." The fireman says, "No, you're not going to do that." They basically said to the fireman, "I don't give a shit what you said." He said, "Wait a minute. I'm a lieutenant or whatever. I don't know about rank."
He's a captain.
He knew, captain. So he was the highest ranking person on the roof. Wow. And he said, "You throw him off and basically I'll report you. I'm the highest ranking guy. Do not throw him off." So it's a fireman that saved his life.
Wow.
They should get credit for that.
They burned a big Klieg light. I was on the fifth floor roof. They burned a Klieg light, shining it down on me. I shut off the light. They sent in a German Shepherd dog.
Wow.
I shot at the floor of the dog, so it was hit by the gravel. And then when I saw the light, there was just a crimson of blood everywhere. And I knew that I was shot, at that time I was shot like four times, but the one that put me down was the one that hit my kidney. And that one hit my kidney, took out the spleen, took out 7 feet of intestines, and then I was down, and I remember a cop coming up to me and saying, "Where you hit, Myles?" And I said, "See my attorney." And he said, "Yeah, we'll show you attorney." A cop took his finger and put it right in my bullet hole. And then Robeson, the cop that I'd beaten up, he was up there. He said, "I'll show you how to make him talk." And he picked me right up on my testicles. Bang, and bang. And then they said, "Yes, let's say he tried one of those karate kicks and fell off the roof." Yeah. So I figured they tried to get me to say no to die. But no, they weren't asking me anything. They were just hauling me towards the roof. And so down below, there was like ABC, NBC, CBS, all pointed towards me. And they got me to the edge of the roof. And I came back. They thought I was dead and unresponsive.
Yeah.
And I came back to life. I said, "They're throwing me off the roof. I'm not falling. They're throwing me off the roof. They help me." And their words were, "Pull him back here and kill him up here. We'll be bothered by the press for the next 2 weeks." And so it was boot kick, boot kick, boot kick. And that's when the fireman came up. And he's the guy that saved my life.
God bless him. How long were you in the hospital after the shot?
I was in the hospital. I was in the Mass General Hospital for about a month. And from there, they'd give me a colostomy. And they had said, don't get a spinal when they close the colostomy because it won't work because your spine has been hit right where they put the spinal. So they brought me to Norfolk, and that's the first time that Jimmy was up there and he met me. And so they did a closure of the colostomy, but that's not where it ends. They did give me a spinal because a nurse can give a spinal. If it's general anesthetic, they have to hire an anesthesiologist. And that costs, like back then, an extra $200. And they didn't want to go that way. So they gave me the spinal. And to relax the muscles, they give you a thing called deturbocurine or intocostrin, which is curare. And they give you that injection because it relaxes all the muscles in the body, except for the heart. And it stops the lungs from going. And you can't move, you can't breathe. They've got a respirator breathing for you. And so they never told me this. I couldn't move my eyes. I couldn't take a breath.
I've had something like that.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Scary.
And then the spinal didn't take effect. So I feel the entire operation. So
and you can't say nothing.
I can't say nothing. Yeah. And so I came at the end of it. I said, look, I feel it. Don't knock me out. I feel what you do, motherfuckers. You know, and I get progressively more angry. So I went into the hospital. Now what happened was they closed the colostomy. 2 days later, they feed me. And I said, should I have an intravenous or a liquid diet? No, you can eat anything. So how ignorant they were, they fed me. I leaked fecal material into my abdomen, got peritonitis, which, as you probably know, is one of the most lethal infections you can get. So they would not send me to an outside hospital. And this is where Jimmy saw me losing pound after pound after pound after pound. And I said, something's wrong with me. My abdomen was like a balloon. And so, then they give me a blood transfusion from the inmates laced with hepatitis, the worst kind. So I turned orange. And but then ultimately they refused. My dad, whose brother was head of the VA, tried everything to get me sent out. They would not send me off. No, no.
Not even Shattuck?
No, not even Shattuck. I don't think they had a hookup with Shattuck back then. But what finally got me moved, that's when I weighed, I was just skin and bones. And my father's brothers finally pulled out enough strings to get me sent to Boston City Hospital.
Boston City, yeah.
And when they pushed me in the gurney, a nurse picked me up, stepped on a scale.
You were that light?
65 pounds.
No far away.
65 pounds, yeah. And then gradually, they had to fight the infection from the peritonitis.
They wanted you to die in Norfolk. They wanted to let you die in Norfolk.
Oh, yeah.
Al used to come and visit me, and he retails his memories of seeing me with all these tubes and to come here and there.
Well, he was there several days. When they took him from, I believe it was when he was so sick, they brought him to Boston City, and that allowed his mother to go, and she didn't drive or anything. So I would take her every day. But in those days, and probably nowadays, especially with him, they had not uniform, but a police officer outside his room. Nobody went in except the doctors. Yeah. They would let his mother go in. So I don't know if I did 2, 3, 5 days, but I'd be standing there with this top, so he knew who I was. And this was around the time when he mentioned the 65 pounds. The detective said to me one day, he says, I shouldn't do this. He said, but go ahead in. It's probably the last time you'll see him. And I went in, and he had things coming out of everywhere. And
conscious?
Barely, but he was like this.
Yeah.
And he asked for, they gave him something to write on. I don't know what he was gonna do, he shouldn't talk. And he just wrote a high pal. And that was the day they had picked him up. And so he weighed 65 pounds. And the police officer outside his door, you know, and then he must have had a little bit of something in him. He just said, hey, this kid's nice enough to bring the mother up, and he's a good friend, and this kid's going to die. So go ahead in and see him.
There's always a few good ones.
Yeah.
So Major John Reagan.
Really?
Yeah. The best.
Yeah.
Nice guy.
Good Irishman.
Yeah. Anyway, that was the 65-pound story. That's the last time you weighed 65 pounds.
I'm sure there's been a few times where you thought he wasn't going to pull through, right?
I mean, the lifestyle he was living, the waking up in the morning and finding out that something had happened, it wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah.
And every time a bank got robbed or something, I would just call him up and I said, you asshole, you know, we've got to play somewhere tonight. You did that, didn't you? I mean, a Milton bank, I knew we did it.
Yeah.
And he was just snitcher.
And didn't you rob a bank before a show one night or something? Did you get caught or something? Something happened?
I think I hid in the basement of the Beachcomber. I hid a bag of money, and it was over $100,000, so it was in the bag. And so it was in the back room of the Beachcomber. I forget who was the janitor that went in there and found
it. It was, I can't think of his name, but he had robbed the bank either the day before or 2 days before, and he carries things around in a brown paper bag, never anything else.
Yeah.
So he came to work. He hadn't robbed it that day, but he had robbed it right around then. And we used the office of the Beachcomber for a dressing room. And he had the money there, and he played that night. And he left the bag there because he knew it would be locked and wherever he was going at night. And the poor kid that always said, I guess you'd call him the janitor, but he was part of the furniture there. I can't think of his name. He went down to clean up Mr. McGetrick's office, and he's doing this bag like he's going to throw it away. And he went, holy shit. he had robbed the bank and then came and played a gig within 48 hours or so.
Yeah. Legend.
Yeah.
So I know Justin's going to be out of here at 3:30. We got about 10 minutes left. So, getting back, I just want to, talk about, this movie. I mean, this is a big deal. You know what I mean? It is. It's just so, like I said, I keep saying the same thing, but it's just so intriguing. And it's just stuff I found interesting. Like I said, every time I'm away, I'm a big true crime book guy anyway. I never read much till I ended up in prison. Then I read everything. That's what I did. I read a ton of books in prison, not just true crime. I read everything, it's a form of escape in there, when you get into a good book. It's almost like sometimes you can't wait to get back to your cell, to finish the book, when you have a good book. It's another thing that's, I had a friend recently, a kid, Charlestown kid, Chris Conn, is a real good kid. And he said something to me one day. He said, you know what you don't hear anymore about someone? Like when you're talking about someone, he said, you'll never hear it again. I said, what? Oh, he's well read.
Yeah.
And I said, it's true, right? Yeah. This day and age, like everyone's on their phone. You won't hear that anymore. Like you hear it, in our generation, he's well-read, right? Mm-hmm. But I feel like I became that guy. I was well-read. I devoured a ton of books, and when you're in 10 block or 9 block or, the max end, right? You're in your cell all the time. It's all you get to do is read books. And sometimes you get some real good ones. And I'm really, really, I talk about that because I read every Boston mob book. I could be the next John Wick, right? I could make I could write the greatest thing. I should, kill these people. I read every one of those books. And so to me, it's just very, you're a very interesting guy. You know what I mean? I have the utmost respect for you. And you're just a legend, in and around here in the criminal world and otherwise. I mean, the whole rock and roll thing and like I said, I don't want to take away from Al, looking into you, Googling you, I'm like, holy shit, this guy's the real deal. Like just amazing, amazing stuff, just so cool to me. And I really want to, pump this movie up. And I'm not just because I'm here with you, like keep talking about it. I have a real interest in this. I can't wait to see it myself. And I'm sure it came out great, we'll be seeing it soon enough. And hopefully I can have you on again. That'll be really good. Now, this time I'm going to have to get the check with dinner unless Anthony or Jimmy wants to grab it. You know what I mean? But Al was gracious enough to buy me and Bundy lunch and everybody. And that restaurant, La Scala?
La Scala.
La Scala in Randolph?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. A good one.
Delicious, delicious food. You know, that was great. And I'm so gracious that you took the time to come down here and come on. And you're out in, can I say where you are? You're living out in
Smithfield, Rhode Island.
Smithfield, Rhode Island.
It's right across from Blackstone.
All right. Maybe I'll head out there one day and take you out for lunch.
I
could talk to you for days. It's just really interesting stuff. So thanks again for coming on. Al, thanks for coming on. I'm going to try to get there on the 17th. Bundy, as always, was very quiet this episode because we were just rambling. And that's it. Was this podcast number 18?
18.
Yes. That's it. 18 in the books, Justin. Thank you. Like a bunch of narcotics. There were. Pull up in a new Robbery. Live it like you got it. Come on. Chopping bricks like karate.